this is a chapter out of a book that I'm writing called Rendition to Torture, which is lengthily published at Rutgers University Press in their Genocide, Political Violence, and Human Rights series. Draft is due February 15th, so I'm a little lucky we got to see writing. This chapter came out of the typewriter this morning, so it may be long enough. The topic tonight is in some ways a familiar one. You've probably heard a great deal about lawyers say that the war in Iraq was illegal and various rationales for that. What I think is different now, particularly now that Bush's memoirs are coming out and you can see the statements of what the defense is, and as you can see what the final argument for the war is, it all really comes down to one question. If you gave the Bush administration lawyers the benefit of the doubt on all sorts of issues, ultimately their argument seems to come down to one thing, and I'll show you why in a minute, and that is that the war was a valid preemptive or anticipatory strike against Saddam Hussein because of the good faith belief that he had weapons of mass destruction and was training terrorists, including Al-Qaeda members, in the use of weapons of mass destruction. Now, that assertion is obviously and palpably wrong. So what the proponents of the war and the legality of the war, for that matter, the legality and morality of war, have to say is that even though we were wrong, we believed it. We believed it, and we were in good faith, and indeed, Bush, in his memoirs, as we just saw that came out the other day, says, look at all the other intelligence agencies in the world who also believed that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction and or was training people of weapons of mass destruction. Well, what he doesn't tell you, and what I will tell you and go over today, is the fact that they hid the evidence from the other intelligence agencies. And they, in fact, had the intelligence from which they either knew or should have known that they were wrong. Well, in order to go through that, we need to just lay some ground rules. First off, why is it that formally, as a matter of formal law, was it illegal? And then granting their sort of expanded notions of preemptive war, even though I think most scholars think they were wrong too, but even if you were to accept them, why it cannot be that it was in good faith. Well, if you go back to the election between Bush and Gore, it's interesting because he said over and over again, he said, one way for us to end up being viewed as the ugly American is for us to go around the world saying, we do it this way and so should you. So he went on to say, nation building exercises are beneath the dignity of a superpower, not in our national self-interest. And that distinguished him from Gore because Gore was going to go out and use our military for nation building and he wasn't. Kind of ironic to go back to the election and just look at what was said. Well, we're now in both Afghanistan and Iraq. So I'm going to give you a 5-minute primer on international laws of war, which track pretty interestingly with what you will get in philosophy courses on the morality of war. But it's not surprising that the law and that which moral philosophers might be saying would overlap. The U.S. was one of the first and primary signatories to the UN Charter. Not surprising, Franklin Roosevelt, before he died, was strongly in favor of a new United Nations, and his wife, Eleanor Roosevelt, pushed it in the San Francisco Conference, and the U.S. was one of the initial signatories to the UN Charter. That means that the U.S. is, as a formal legal matter, bound by the requirements of the UN Charter. People who don't like international law, are sort of whistling in the wind on that because we signed it, we agreed to it, it's a matter of contract, it's a matter of positive law, this is not a matter of some mushy, customary state practice or anything like that, it's a formal requirement that we signed off on. The UN Charter allows the use of military force in two and only two respects. And that is, the first one is that under chapter 7, is that if the UN Security Council authorizes armed intervention. And the second is self-defense. And self-defense is narrowly defined as self-defense where one has been attacked, where there's an armed force attacking you. So it would appear on its face as a formal matter to rule out preemptive or anticipatory self-defense, which is the primary reason that Bush and company went into the war. So you will notice right off the bat in this lecture that I'm giving Bush a point that many of you probably wouldn't give him, and indeed I wouldn't give it to him anyway, except I'm doing this as more of a hypothetical thought experiment. Let's give him the point and then see where it leads. See if you could plausibly have a lawful war, even if you assumed every legal point asserted by the Bush administration. Well, need to make one other formal distinction about international law, and that is you often see the blue-headed UN soldiers around the world, and they're in some pretty tough situations. Sometimes the bullets are flying, sometimes at Srebrenica there were genocide going on, people were being killed, but as a formal and as a practical matter, they don't count. So they're not really a part of what we're talking about, because as a matter of UN Charter, and as a matter of practice as much as they can be, they're not combatants, they're supposed to come in as neutral agents, they only come in at the invitation of the warring or hostile parties, and so peacekeeping forces under Chapter 6 of the Charter don't count. And so the blue hats, essentially, that you see in Rwanda and the former Yugoslavia and different places, we will exclude them from analysis simply because they're not at least technically combatants. So otherwise, then you have self-defense and you have the Charter. Well, where does that leave such things as, for example, humanitarian intervention, which many of you may have talked about in some of your classes, particularly if you take classes in moral philosophy and the laws of war? Well, since World War II, state practice has, as a customary matter, diverged from the formal requirements of the Charter. And so it is argued that there are exceptions, that even though the formal legal rules have applied and technically make illegal virtually every war since World War II, with the exception of the Korean police action and a few other things, nonetheless, state action has been such that, and state practice has been such, that it allowed people to go into places such as Somalia, moving Black Hawk down. And so the question is, can you have humanitarian intervention? And if you could, does either the war in Afghanistan or the war in Iraq count as a humanitarian intervention? Well, the answer is almost certainly no. Almost no one thinks that you can intervene willy-nilly just because there's a bad situation or a mean dictator or something like that. You have to have some precise criteria, the first and foremost of which is that there's mass killings or the imminent threat of mass killings. Notice that by 2001 in Afghanistan and in 2003 in Iraq, neither of those cases had any plausible threat of the kind of mass killings that they're talking about. It wasn't like Srebrenica. Yes, Iraq had mass killings in 1990 in the first Gulf War. Yes, there were thousands who were gassed, both the Kurds and all of the Arabs down on the waterway, I forget the name of it. Yeah, there were all of those sorts of mass killings in 1990, but by 2001, Saddam Hussein had been essentially defanged. There were no mass killings. Yes, there was torture and killing going on, but it was on a relatively small scale, not the kind of which would have allowed for military intervention, which is a very different sort of thing. And similarly with Afghanistan, the Taliban were a thoroughly obnoxious and nasty group of people. They were particularly massacre to women. Women's rights were horribly and terribly violated in both of those countries. But it wasn't the kinds of mass killings that would meet the first criterion. First, Nakhchivan, your purpose has to be to stop the widespread threats to life, not to, for example, get oil or pipeline. You have to use proportionate means. I suppose that's one of the reasons why you have to have mass killings and not just a few, because war ends up in lots of people dying. And so it's got to be mass killings just from the, it seems almost intuitively obvious that would be the case. You have to make attempts for peaceful resolution. Well, if you look at Afghanistan, we went 3 weeks to try to resolve that one, and then turned down the Taliban shortly after the war began, when they offered to turn over al-Qaeda to an international court. So one might argue that the attempts were pretty thin, but I guess some attempts were made. Let's, for a hypothetical situation, just give the Bush administration that one. Doesn't hurt us, because it's still going to come out the same way. There has to be a collective intervention. Well, what was the collective intervention in Iraq? U.S., Great Britain, Palau? Nobody else gained over a couple hundred soldiers. It was collective in name, sort of only, 38 nations, of which two actually really did anything. Afghanistan was a little more collective, and that was a slightly different case. And finally, the danger must be imminent to avert mass killings, and of course that doesn't apply. I think we can safely say, and I think even most of the diehard adherents to the Bush administration would admit that humanitarian intervention doesn't account or justify either war. The main difference between Afghanistan is twofold. First off, there were various resolutions that at least arguably, and I say arguably, plausibly, allowed for the intervention in Afghanistan by a coalition. Now, I'm not going to go through the reading of them. There is some controversy. Professor Michael Mandel at Osgoode Hall at York University radically disagrees with that analysis and says that it didn't bear that construction of the UN resolution didn't allow for even the invasion of Afghanistan, much less Iraq. But I'll pass that by, because I think the Bush administration could plausibly, and I say plausibly only, could have argued that it was a matter of self-defense. Now, Michael Mandel argues that that was just pretextual, and his evidence for it is, first off, when Donald Rumsfeld told President Bush that international law allowed the use of force only to prevent future attacks and not for retribution, Bush said, "I don't care what the international lawyers say, we're going to kick some ass." And then at another time he said, "Any barriers in your way, they're gone." Well, any reasonable interpretation of that language suggests that the Bush administration had made up its mind to go to war both in Afghanistan and in Iraq, and were merely looking for a pretext to invade. And Michael Mandel and some other scholars, and I assume Michael Mensch here as well, would argue from that the war was merely pretextual and illegal. And they may be right as a formal matter. I don't want to debate that. What I want to do is to distinguish Afghanistan from Iraq, to point out how completely obvious it is that Iraq was illegal. And so let's, again, whatever side you come out on that, let's give them that one. And there are some reasons why you might give them that one. For one thing, those words, they were said by the former President Bush, but they are out of context, after all, with a lot of other things that were said by a lot of people. And at the very least, one could argue that the war in Afghanistan was self-defense. After all, if you just look at what the Taliban had done, they had in fact done a warlike act, killing nearly 3,000 people in the trade center. They had, or at least the al-Qaeda had. And al-Qaeda had so wrapped itself into the Taliban that it's at least arguable that there was no way they could give up the al-Qaeda agents, and it's at least arguable that they were a plausible imminent threat making necessary the war. I don't ask you to agree with those arguments. I just ask that you consider them as at least plausible. And the reason why I would suggest to you that that is one way that you should at least consider it is the fact that as a practical matter, most nations in the world have in fact accepted that interpretation. And so whether you disagree with it or not, we may as well go on with the practical matter. So, what about the war in Iraq? Well, the first thing to point out, as long as we're talking about formal legal matters, is that Resolution 1483, after the fact, allowed the coalition forces to administer Iraq following the war. So one might argue, well, that legitimizes. However, that resolution did not even purport at all to retroactively legitimize the war. So that if the war was illegal, it was illegal, period. That resolution doesn't help them at all. So the US relied on security resolutions for the earlier Iraq war, primarily the invasion of Kuwait and the resolution providing serious consequences if Iraq failed to turn over its weapons of mass destruction. The first interpretation is ludicrous. It's pretty easy to point out that the Gulf War, the first 1990 Gulf War in Iraq, only allowed for the liberation of Kuwait. And so to argue that that somehow bootstrapped and allowed in 2003 to invade Iraq is simply silly. And the Bush administration advanced it, and advanced it with a straight face, but I don't think they could have seriously meant that. It's just not a plausible interpretation of that resolution. The other one, 1441, which allowed or said that there would be serious consequences, a little history is important here, because when that resolution was passed in 2002, the US tried to get through an explicit authorization for war and was denied it. So it's pretty clear from the history that it was never intended to authorize a war, and it doesn't say so. It doesn't bear that construction. So as a formal matter, the war in Iraq was neither humanitarian intervention, nor was it even plausibly a result of the resolutions. So what the Bush administration ultimately comes down to is the notion that it's a preemptive war. And I'll try to get to that very quickly because I see I've almost used up 20 minutes and I promised I'd try to shut up and give you time for questions. But give me just four or five more minutes. Four things in increasing order of importance. The first one that you all know about, because I know Greg keeps bending my ear about it, and I think it's the least plausible of the arguments, but students often think it's the best. And that is that Hans Blix, in his report prior to the war, basically said that Iraq wasn't doing that bad. It wasn't full cooperation, but give us more time. And he even said, look, CIA, if you have evidence of weapons caches, tell us where they are, we're going to get them. And the Bush administration blew that away and basically ignored Blix and ignored both the UN and the atomic energy people. And so that is some evidence. The Bush administration pushed back at Blix, called him a fool and a dupe, claimed he had no credibility, and they've never apologized, even though it's clear that he was right and they were wrong. He pretty much says that the US government had the same mind frame as witch hunters of the past, looking for evidence to support a foregone conclusion. And I think he's right, but I don't think the evidence coming from Blix is the strongest. I think there's better evidence than that. The second thing is, I've already talked about, so I'll just mention it, is the UN resolution, the fact that historically the US tried to get a resolution and failed. But there are two things that I think are far more important than any of that, two things you all probably know fairly little about. First off, do you remember when Colin Powell goes before the UN and says, we have incontrovertible proof that Iraq not only has weapons of mass destruction, but that he is training Al-Qaeda agents in their use. You remember that? You know where, does anybody here know where that came from? Anybody here know that?
Yeah, it was induced from torture, wasn't it?
Yeah. It's worse than that. That's all the evidence they had. They had a guy named Al-Libi. They pick him up in Pakistan. FBI agents and CIA agents start questioning. They get lots of good information from him. Turns out that he is a bad guy. He was a training agent for Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan. He had never been to Iraq, knew nothing about Iraq, provably. I mean, the CIA knew he had never been to Iraq. Some contractors, presumably from Blackwater, decide he's not telling everything. The FBI says, wait, don't take him from us. We need him for the Massawi case. My good friend Jerry Zirkin defended Massawi, did a brilliant job. And the Richard Reed Schubomber case, neither of which was a lead pipe cinch. They needed the evidence. Keep in mind, Massawi, although he was convicted, didn't get the death penalty. Zirkin did a terribly good job representing him. And they needed all of his evidence. The CIA snatched him away. There was a fight between the FBI director, whose name I'm forgetting at the moment, and Tenet. Tenet goes to Bush, wins. The CIA contractors take him to Egypt, where he's tortured. They beat the hell out of him. He then says whatever they want, including that things that he couldn't have known, and they knew he couldn't have known, which is includes that Al-Qaeda is training, or rather, Saddam Hussein is training agents, terrorist agents in use of weapons of mass destruction. That's Colin Powell's sole evidence. Now, fast forward, Al-Libi comes to Guantanamo Bay, and he's an embarrassment. So what does the Bush administration do? Here's a guy who knows too much. What happens to people who know too much? They send him to Libya, where he allegedly hangs himself with a bedsheet in his hotel. I'll tell you this, nobody on my side of the political spectrum believes that. Can I prove that he was murdered? Do I think he was probably murdered? Yeah, it doesn't ring right, does it? So we have Al-Libi, who now conveniently cannot testify to anything. And keep in mind, Al-Libi was witness number one in a lot of these Guantanamo trials. The defense was pushing to get him all over the map. Now, notice the prosecution never wants him. He's tainted goods, right? He's gone. And why is it, ask yourself this, of all of the people at Guantanamo Bay, only one was shipped to Libyan prison? Al-Libi. Now, if that were all the evidence I would have, you might say, okay, Professor Clark, it's pretty damning. And it doesn't look like the Bush administration was acting in particularly good faith, but it's not conclusive proof. If that's all you have, then at least some people are going to give him the benefit of the doubt. Am I right? There's one more thing. And this one, I think, when you take with the Al-Libi thing, you have to decide is really powerful. Turns out that the second highest intelligence agent in Saddam Hussein's intelligence service was a double agent. And another high intelligence agent, not quite as high as him, was also a double agent. So we have two moles within the Iraqi secret intelligence service. And they were asked, under circumstances where they had no reason to lie, because we were getting ready to invade, right? Scary stuff. Under circumstances where they had no reason to lie, they were asked about weapons of mass destruction. You know, they told our CIA, we don't have them. They're a myth, they're a mirage, we don't have them. Now, if that's still all we had, I would say, okay, Bush, you got me. Other intelligence agencies all around the world thought you had weapons of mass destruction. Maybe you still had some shred of it. But guess what? How many intelligence agencies, including the British MI5 or MI6, did we tell? notice Tony Blair is in a hell of a fix in politically. He wants to go to war with Bush, called him Bush's poodle. But he had to persuade his Attorney General Goldsmith that the war was lawful. And Goldsmith gives him that opinion over the resignation of other lawyers within the Attorney General's office in Great Britain, who said, this is bullshit. It's an illegal war, you can't do it. You need a Supreme Council resolution. Now we're getting back to the formal stuff that I had to do, the formal legal poo-poo to make this make sense. You see how this is all connecting up, I hope. Notice, I don't think there's anyone in this room who thinks that had Great Britain not joined the coalition, Bush would have been able to get away with the war. It was the fact that Brits didn't come to the war. And intelligence agents high up in Great Britain are saying, had they known about the two Iraqi intelligence agents, Britain likely would not have gone to war. So, and I realize I've taken 5 minutes longer than I said I was going to, I'm sorry for that. It's a lot of material. You can see that it's a 39-page essay that I've written, which goes into it in far greater detail than I can go in a quick talk. But I conclude that even if you ignore that fact that it was a formally illegal war, in violation of both the resolutions of the UN Security Council, including 1441, and even if you concede the doctrine of preemptive war, which I maintain is not a valid doctrine, but even if you were to do that, you cannot conclude that the Bush administration, in good faith, thought, or could have thought. Indeed, what you have, anybody here that are legal studies majors? No? Well, there's this test in commercial law called the pure heart or white heart and empty head test. And that's what I would suggest applies to the Bush administration. If they claim to have a pure heart, then the only thing you can say is they must have had an empty head. Any questions? I know it's a lot. I've gone over what really is a lot of material in a very quick, short compass. Laws, resolutions, cases, and all sorts of stuff.
Well, let's give a hand first.
Huh? Anybody want to...